The Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, and in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. The first time I read this as a new believer, I thought that Paul was out of his mind. Who in the world delights in being insulted? Delights in hardships and being rejected and abandoned and persecuted? It wasn't those things that he delighted in any more than do we delight in the pain of Christ on the cross. It's the result that we delight in. He says that the result of such things is a revelation of strength. The Amplified Bible in the same verse says, I am well pleased with weaknesses, with insults, with distresses, with persecutions, and with difficulties for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak in human strength, then I am strong, truly able, truly powerful, truly drawing from God's strength. So the end goal is that I'm learning that God is stronger than I am. I'm learning that God is smarter than I am. That God has more resources than I do. Now you would think, who needs to learn that, Dave? We got that down pretty good. I don't think if I take a raise of hands here tonight that anyone would go, I think I'm stronger than God. I think I'm smarter than God. We wouldn't say that, but we do believe that. And someone telling us the difference is not what makes the difference. It's a lesson that's learned by fire. By, you ready? Pain. It's through the pain of failure, the gift of pain, that we learn and receive the revelation that God is stronger, that God is smarter, that God is more able. It's when I'm weak, I learn He is strong. Pain. It's a gift. Do you know that leprosy in the Bible is a type of sin in the Old Testament? Leprosy desensitizes someone. They don't feel. You've seen pictures of people with leprosy and they're messing a digit, messing an arm. It's not so much that it fell off, it's that they did things that damaged themselves and didn't even know they were hurting themselves because they could not feel the pain to say, don't go there. See, you can't even have really pleasure without pain. Because a nerve is something that causes you to, well, feel, right? Now, we would love nerve endings that only feel pleasure but never feel pain. Hey, how about that? God, we think you might have missed the mark on creation. If I was creating nerves, I would create them just to feel good but not to feel bad. My sciatica, for example, Lord, I'm not too happy about the way that feels, right? But the deal is pain's a gift. And from within the womb, we feel pain. Do you know that? From within the womb. How about that? I've actually seen videos, tragic as though it is, of attempted abortions where they're trying to suck the baby out of the womb. And when that vacuum's coming at it and probing it, you know what that baby does? It jerks away because it's saying, I feel that. They've done studies on premature preemies where they feel pain, you see. Why? Do you know that the firing of neurons in our brain through sensitivity, whether it's comfort or pain, develops the very brain itself? Interesting. So pain is part of developing our brain. Pleasure is part of developing our brain. Feeling is part of it. The brain is only symbolic of something that's eternal, which is our soul. Let me tell you what, pain deepens the soul. It's not that we love pain, it's that we love Christ's character that is produced through it. As I thought about talking with you more about this Wednesday, if you weren't here last Wednesday, we covered the gift of pain part one, but I know some of you are gluttons for punishment and masochists at heart, and you want some more pain, so prepare yourselves tonight. A quote I've been playing around with for the last couple weeks: from within the womb to the grave, pain is the paper upon which personal revelation is penned and received. The very blood by which we were redeemed was produced through pain. No servant is greater than his master, and if we're called to follow Christ and live for Christ's sake, then we will share in his sufferings to share in his glory. As he was perfected through pain, so shall we be. You say, Dave, I'm not saved through pain, I'm saved through faith and grace. True. But you're sanctified through pain, child of God, believe me. As I pondered upon such a principle in God's word, I thought about, Lord, where do you want us to go? What's a narrative? What's a picture of this spiritual truth that transforms our lives? And I thought last week as we looked at the Apostle Paul, who proclaimed, when I'm weak, I'm strong. We looked at Job a little bit, of someone who loved God, but yet it was through great suffering, grief, and loss that there was a deepening of humility and a revelation of a lingering, hindering, underlining pride in his life. Both incredible characters to look at. But as we consider that this revelation of glory comes through pain, even from within the womb, I thought of no one better to look at than the story of, well, Jacob. Look with me at Genesis chapter 25, verse 21. The scripture says that Isaac pleaded with the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord granted his plea. And Rebekah, his wife, conceived. But the children struggled together within her. And she said, if all is well, why am I like this? So she went to inquire of the Lord. That's always a good thing to do when you're confused. Amen? Go to the Lord. Because why? God will answer you. The Lord said to her, two nations are in your womb. Two peoples shall be separated from your body. One people shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger. So when her days were fulfilled for her to give birth, indeed, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red. He was like a hairy garment all over. So they called him Esau, which means hairy. Afterward, his brother came out, and his hand took hold of Esau's heel. So his name was called Jacob, which various translations, deceiver, successor, or even heel grabber. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. Let's stop there. Wow. From within the womb, there was a battle going on. Isaac had two sons, Esau and Jacob, and from within the womb, they're battling for control and for, if you would, identity. See, whoever was going to be born first would have the double portion inheritance. Amazing how you see these two sons from within the womb duking and battling it out. I find that so poetic because that pretty much speaks of our life as human beings. From within the womb, we're battling it out for control and for identity. Isn't it true? We do it through career, through finances, through positioning, promotion, recognition, fame, materialism, all these things. But we're all seeking out some type of control to assure security, to secure trust, safety, ultimately identity. And we can never find it outside of Jesus, amen? But the more that we seek it out, you know what we get instead? Someone answer my question, what do we get? Pain. We do. We get pain. That's what Jacob got. A life full of pain. See, his life was not an easy one if you've studied the story of Jacob. His very name, meaning Mr. Tricky Guy, so he's growing up and he's called, hey, Tricky, hey, Conniver. That can kind of mess with your head, right? That explains a lot of things with my firstborn son. I had to throw that in there. My heart in naming him Jacob was successor, and that has been fulfilled prophetically. But of course, that back then names meant a lot more specifically detailed, and that's not a name you want to grow up with. But he grew up not only with this name that meant, hey, Mr. Schemer, but he grew up with mom playing favorites and dad looking at him as his second fiddle. Because, see, if you study the story of Jacob, Isaac favored Esau. Esau was, well, your spiritual Rambo. He was the hunter. He was the guy in the house that just, he talked like a man, lived like a man. He was a man's man, and Isaac just seemed to favor him. So here Jacob grows up being mama's boy, living in the tent, but knowing dad will never really favor him. His brother condescending. He grows up living like this for 63 years. When it comes time to receive the blessing from dad, to receive the first portion, the story goes that mom favoring Jacob, talk about a dysfunctional household to say the least, right? She kind of says, hey, I tell you what, why don't you get this skin around here? It's going to feel like burlap. We're going to wrap your arms with it, and we're going to make it feel like you're some hairy animal, so that way when dad, Isaac, touches you, he'll think you're Esau. So I want you to pretend, get some camouflage on, and I want you to pretend to be somebody you're not, Jacob. I not only want you to pretend to be something you're not, when you're asked who you are, lie and say you're somebody else. The man is 63 years old, still being led and manipulated by mommy. Poster child for arrested development. He goes in and lies and receives the blessing and fulfills actually a prophecy that was foretold to Rebekah 63 years ago, where he says, the older shall serve the younger. Remember that? Now, when Esau finds out about this deception that takes place, Esau is ready to pull out the Uzi and run after Jacob. He's dead meat. So now there's all kinds of... So clearly, not a healthy marriage, not healthy relationship with the siblings, major identity crisis going on with Jacob in a huge way, right? And now Esau wants to kill him. So Jacob runs and he leaves. Now he has to leave his homeland and run and go into hiding. And he comes to a place called Bethel. At least he calls it so, meaning the house of God. And he finds himself running, 63-year-old man, running away from dad and mom, and his brother wants to kill him, and he's laying there one night sleeping with his head on a rock. Let me tell you, when you're running from your problems, you don't sleep well, do you? And he has this dream, incredible dream. I wish we had time to really study all this, but the point is that God shows him this incredible picture of the gospel. This stairway to heaven with angels ascending and descending. And God shows up and talks with Jacob. In other words, Jacob is rebellious, running from his problems, running from his pain, and God shows up and says, I'm establishing covenant with you, and it's by grace, not that you've earned this. It's a picture of the gospel. In other words, it's an Old Testament typology of someone, if you would, getting saved. I find it compelling that the first thing that Jacob does after this picture of the gospel of grace and promised Messiah and presence of God, the first thing he does, he says, you know what? I'm going to give you a tenth of all that I have and all I'll ever get. Interesting. For all those of you that want to say, well, I don't tithe. That's the law. No, it's actually pre-law. And it was the first thing, a sign of a surrendered heart that says, you know what? I don't deserve anything but death, and yet because you've shown me such grace, I just want to offer this to you as a sign of my heart belongs to you. How cool is that? And so at that point, Jacob has this, well, experience with God that transformed his heart, but he's still got a lot of growing and changing to do, that's for sure. And he comes across an uncle by the name of Laban. Tricky Laban. He made Jacob look like on the straight and narrow, this guy. Bad news. He had a couple daughters, one Leah and one Rachel, and he fell in love with Rachel. He began to serve there in Laban's business with the flock, and of course, he agrees to serve Laban 7 years for the wife, to have Rachel as a wife, and serve 7 years, and after the wedding, all of a sudden, Laban brings, we thought, Rachel to the tent, and he wakes up in the morning, it happens to be Leah there instead, Mr. Tricky Laban. I've always wondered, how did that possibly, I mean, what were you drinking, Jacob? Wouldn't you know her voice after 7 years that was not Rachel, but Leah? And the story goes on that Jacob was not pleasantly surprised because Leah was not exactly Miss America. She was known to be very homely, if you would. That's just, the Bible says that very clearly. So actually, Laban says, oh, you know what? I'll tell you what, if you serve me for another 7 years, then you can have Rachel. That's what he does. So this guy's serving for 14 years to have these two women. In this process of serving Laban, he becomes extremely rich. A couple daughters, 11 sons at this point in history, which we're about to touch base on. Incredible, but here's the thing. Meanwhile, it's coming up on 20 years now at this point where we're about to jump in on the story. 20 years, and he has not dealt with the situation with dad, with mom, with his brother Esau. In other words, he's got all these problems in the past, all this pain in his past that he's never dealt with. I think it's kind of like us. We have an experience that causes us to run, and then God says, I'm going to meet you right where you're at. We get saved, right? And what we want to do is go, man, now that I've met God, now that heaven has been opened up to me, and now that my heart is surrendered to him, we just want to like move forward and leave the past in the past. How's that working for you? It doesn't work. And it wasn't working for Jacob, for that matter, either. And the deal is that God is actually going to tell Jacob, you need to face your past. And that's what God wants us to do. Even after we get saved, when we experience salvation, a big part of our sanctification is, he says, you've got this stuff in the past, and I want you to go deal with it face to face. Because by dealing with the pain of the past, which is a gift, I want you to know, by dealing with that face to face, we run a parallel experience of seeing God face to face. Not for the faint of heart. Genesis 31, it says, Jacob heard the words of Laban's son, saying, Jacob has taken away all that was our father's, and from what was our father's, he has acquired all his wealth. And Jacob saw the countenance of Laban, and indeed it was not favorable toward him as before. Then the Lord said to Jacob, return to the land of your fathers and to your family. I love this part. And I will be with you. It's time to deal with your stuff, Jake. I've loved you. I approached you when you were running from everything that I was trying to speak to you through, and dishonoring your parents, dishonoring the law, dishonoring me. I met you right where you're at and showed you a wonderful grace. And we began a relationship. It was a honeymoon. There was a real spring on your step at that point. It was amazing. And I blessed you all these years, even though you've run from your past, even though you've run from your pain, you haven't faced it, even though I've still blessed you. Aren't you so glad God's favor and blessing isn't contingent upon whether we do all we should do? Right? But see, there does come to a place where God says, we're going to deal with this. Because I love you, I'm going to take you where you would not choose to go on your own. You go, Dave, you always say that. Yeah, I know. We need to keep hearing it. Because that's part of growing up. And it's time where God's saying, Jake, I want you to go back home and I want you to deal with this. See, we're going to find here in this story that Jacob goes from experience at Bethel 20 years ago, when he was 63, he's 83 years old now, right? from Bethel, this happy honeymoon skip in his step, that God says, now I'm going to lead you to a place that's not so much pleasurable, but very painful. God is leading this 83-year-old man, that's his little boy, to a place of pain, because you can't have true change and sanctification and maturity in the Spirit without it being companioned with pain. It's just part of life. We can run from it, we can medicate, we can take drugs, we can sign up for distractions. We might even go through that for 20 years, some of us longer, but sooner or later, God's going to allow things to dry up, as he did with Laban. God did not allow Jacob to have favor with Laban anymore. God hardened Pharaoh's heart. I believe he hardened Laban's heart. I believe says, I want you to go back, and I'm going to inspire you to want to deal with your problems, because where you're at has problems. So you might as well go deal with the problems you really need to deal with, so where you're at has problems anyway. So what takes place is, of course, Jacob packs up all his wealth that used to be Laban's, and that's why Laban's sons are pretty upset. So here he's packing up, and if you read through the chapters in Genesis, you just see all the wealth that Jacob's acquired, and the sons and daughters and his wives and all this. So he starts heading back to Canaan, and on his way, he sees that Esau's on his way to meet him, and he has 400 men with him. God, you told me to go reconcile and deal with stuff, and here I can see my brother has an arm and he wants to kill me. That would be a little frightening, don't you think? So what does Jacob do? Well, instead of praying, he plots. He says, you know what? I'm going to send him a new Escalade. I'm going to send him a nice big fat check. And what he starts to do is he starts to separate and divide all of his wealth and his herds and starts to send them that way in kind of like little gifts, a gift here, a gift here, a gift there, and all to schmooze Esau. So even though he might have been saved 20 years later, he's still highly dysfunctional. Genesis chapter 32, it says, he arose that night and took his two wives, his female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed over the ford of Jabbok, a river. He took them, sent them over the brook, and sent them over what he had. Then Jacob was left alone, significant. A man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw what he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaks. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And he said to him, what is your name? And he said to Jacob, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Then Jacob asked, saying, tell me your name, I pray. He said, why is it that you ask about my name? And he blessed him there. So Jacob called the name of that place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. Just as he crossed over Peniel, the sun rose on him, and he limped on his hip. Wow. Here Jacob finds himself all alone. He sends everyone away on the other side of this brook, Jabbok, and God says, now I'm going to deal with you that you're all alone. I think that's when God really starts to deal with us, is when we're all alone. See, like Jacob family, we spend a lifetime of accumulating things, and we do that to try and find out who we are. What our bank account looks like, what kind of college we went to, what kind of body we can build and develop, who we're marrying, who we're not marrying, what church we go to, what doctrinal distinctives I cling on to as my spiritual identity. I could go on. We spend a whole life. But what happens is, prayerfully, is we come to a place where all of it is not accessible and there's nothing there but we're us and we're all alone. The gift of pain is meant, number one, you ready? listen closely to this, to change your God. To change your God. See, a lot of you know the story, or partial pieces of it, I should say, where Kathy and I went through our 911 some 17, 18 years ago. And I loved Jesus so much at that time. I really did. I loved the Lord. But God had revealed to me through cataclysmic pain that my identity was based in what my wife thought of me more than what God thought of me. For real. Now, if someone would have said that to me prior to the trial, I would have said, you're out of your mind. But I came to a place in my life where I felt all alone, forsaken by everyone. That's where pain leads us to. See, we spend years accumulating things to not only tell us who we are when God says, I'm the only one who can do that, but we spend years accumulating things to numb us to the pain that's actually the gift to drive us to the place where we can meet with God so he can establish our identity that sin stole. See, God gave Jacob a limp that he might lean on God. Without the limp, he would never lean on God. Without the pain, I never would have pressed into God. That's a fact. Without disillusionment and disappointment in this world, none of us would ever get saved, right? Why would we get saved if we were content not being saved? The revelation of pain that this world brings and all the things we seek to find out who we are, all the things that we seek to find trust and security, all those things, and they disappoint. Without the pain of that disappointment, we would never say, Jesus, I need you. Now, we all come to that place, but I want you to know that's just the beginning. That's not the end. That's just the beginning. That's salvation. Sanctification usually for many begins years down the road. As we've said, I want to be saved, but I still want to hold on to the things that block the pain that's meant to lead me to a deeper well with you. And that's exactly what happens here. See, while Jacob's all alone, this angel shows up and begins to wrestle with him. Now, we know from already reading the text that that angel was none other than Jesus Christ. Now, this angel is wrestling with Jacob. Now, don't you think that Jesus, the pre-incarnate Christ, could have overtaken little Jacob anytime he wanted to? Of course he could have, without a doubt. But it's kind of like I can remember me wrestling with my Jacob when he was like 5 or 6 years old, and I'd wrestle with him, and in his mind, he might have thought he was keeping up with me. He was wrong. It was just me saying, so how far can you go? How much you got, buddy? And so here, Jesus is like wrestling with Jacob and going, you're just not giving up. You just, no matter what. It wasn't that Jesus was going, well, you really got one up on me here, Jacob. No, he's just going, wow. And then he comes to a place where he knocks Jacob's hip out of socket. In other words, Jacob, you're not going to be able to run anymore. You've been doing it for 20 years. But not anymore. Today, Jacob, it's time to stop. And let me tell you what, the writer, Hosea, speaks of, and listen closely to this in Hosea 12, speaking of Jacob, it says, he took his brother by the heel in the womb, and in his strength he struggled with God, referring to the angel. Yes, he struggled with the angel and prevailed. He wept and sought favor from him. Let me tell you what, Jacob is in pain. You ever had something knocked out of socket? God brought Jacob pain. Didn't we just read that? God says, I'm going to bring pain in your life. Wow. That's one of those areas of scripture that I go, God, I'm not sure I like that, that you actually bring pain to people. Yeah. Because unless I give you the pain, unless I give you the limp, you won't lean on my strength. You'll continue to rely upon your own. And so I'm going to give you something that you won't like so you can have something that you'll love, which is a deeper relationship with me. But you're going to have to let go of something that you're holding onto. You have to confront something that you don't want to confront. And here you see in the midst of this pain, it was after the pain, after the change of his God, right? His God used to be, wow, I have these wives. I have all this materialism. I have this tribe. I have this reputation. Now it's all removed and only thing that's there is God, right? And what changes? His prayer life changes. He's talking to God in a whole different way. His way he's talking to God is, you know what? I'm holding on to you and I'm not letting go until you bless me. In other words, I'm not looking to someone else. I'm not looking to a counselor. I'm not looking to a church. I'm not looking to a pill. I'm not looking to anything. I'm holding on to you, Jesus, because I've let go of hope of anything or anyone else fixing this. Here's the deal, guys. We've all got a world of pain. All of us. I don't care how we walk in here with a big smile. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Brother, God is so good. You're hurting and you know it. You know you are. There's stuff there. I'm not saying everyone's always thinking about it, but it's there. And God says, I want to deal with it. We have to be willing to say, I welcome you to search my heart, test my thoughts, see if there be any way offensive in me and lead me in the way everlasting. What is that prayer all about in Psalms 139? It's saying, God, I'm not going to sit here in denial. I'm not going to justify. I'm not going to take Bible verses and just schmooze it over. No, Lord, I'm going to welcome you to go and do whatever you want. And it's going to hurt, God. It's going to hurt to deal with it. I don't want to deal with that divorce. I know so many Christians who get divorced and they go, oh man, it was the best thing I ever did. You ever heard somebody say that? You go, yeah, me, Dave, yeah. It's the best thing I ever did. Then it tells me you haven't dealt with the pain that God is going to allow to be a gift to you to drive you to a deeper well with him. We have all kinds of Judases in our life. We have all types of abuse, physical, mental, spiritual, sexual abuse, all these things in our life that we're going to go, wow, you're saying all that's a gift from God? Yes. Dave, how can I rejoice in that type of abuse? I said it earlier. It's not that we rejoice that Christ died for us. We don't rejoice in the pain any more than the Father was in heaven going, this is great watching my son suffer. Do you think the Father enjoyed that? He didn't enjoy that any more than he enjoyed watching you suffer. Are you betrayed? Are you abused? He didn't enjoy that. Sin is sin. It's a disease in this world, and we need redemption. We need rescuing from it. But for us to actually cry out to God, which is a lifetime process, pain is what leads us there. That's the gift, my friend. That's what takes us to that place to go, God, I'm going to cry out to you. My prayer life is going to a whole different dimension, as did Jacob's at that place. But not only does it change our God and our prayer life, it changes our very walk. Let me tell you what, Jacob limped for the rest of his life. It's amazing after you experience the humility of pain that you can't do anything about. And you go to God and you trust in him and you seek him and you cry out to him. Let me tell you what, you go through that, it changes the way you see everything, the way that you live, the way you have compassion for people, the way that you listen, the way that you love. It just changes everything. Can you imagine what it was like for Jacob crossing and limping over the river Jabbok and going to his kids and saying, kids, I saw God face to face. I saw him. I experienced him. Dad, why are you limping? The Lord's allowing a pain in my life because without it, I wouldn't be qualified. For what he wants to do in me and through me down the road, I wouldn't be qualified because I was just too arrogant and too prideful and too in denial about all the stuff in my past. And I just covered it over with, I'm saved by grace. I just covered it over with, I'm a new creation. I just covered it over with, I've given that to God, but I really hadn't. And I didn't have the humility to really deal with it. So God inflicted some pain. He inflicted some hardship. He took away my ability to be in denial anymore. And when you come to that place, that crossroad, whether you cross over or not is all contingent upon whether you're going to hold on to God or whether you're going to push God away. God, how could you do this? How could you cause this pain in my life? Versus, Lord, I know that you caused. Why would Jacob be asking someone who inflicted pain on him to bless him? You ever heard people say, I just can't trust God because if he really loves me, why does he allow things like this to happen? You don't understand the dynamics of a relationship with God yet. You're still a baby, spiritually. And God helps us grow up. Sometimes it takes 20 years. Sometimes it takes a longer time, but sooner or later, God's going to say, I'm going to touch you in an area that's going to bring pain, and you're going to weep. You're going to cry out, and it's going to be something where you're going to go, there's no other place to go to deal with this but God. And I'm going to you, and I'm not letting go because I know God. Now, did he heal his pain? Was the blessing fixing his hip? Not at all. Matter of fact, verse 32 of chapter 32 says, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip because the socket of Jacob's hip was touched near the tendon. Wow. Interesting symbolism. What is it saying to me? I tell you what it says to me, that when we need to accept that the disability that comes from God brings about a spiritual ability. When God gives a disability or a pain, it's something to bring the revelation and blessing of a spiritual ability. Now, I'm not trying to say God can't heal and God can't resolve numerous. Of course, absolutely. But I think there's a bigger picture with, God, what are you doing in me through this? Are you trying to do something? Are you trying to open my heart up that I've been running from you? And I'm saying that I love you, but the truth of it is I'm still finding my identity in that I have the gift of prophecy, that I have my identity in that I lead worship. I have my identity in that I'm a giver. And I give a lot, or I go and I feed the poor, and I do these things, and we find our identity in the stuff we do for God. You know what? That doesn't work. That's just a religious facade, right? It's kind of like what Jacob was doing. Remember he was putting camouflage on his arms, pretending to be something he's not? That's what we're doing when we're finding our identity in all the things that we do. It does not work. And God says, how do we get there? By willing to deal with the stuff that we just don't want to deal with. What is it you think that you're dealing with tonight? What is God saying to you that you can go, you know what? I've been pretending to be something I'm not. I want you to know that God will allow pain in your life because not only does he want to change your God and your idea of who you worship and change your prayer life to something incredible, change your walk to something that people see as truly spiritual. Check it out. He wants to change your name. How cool is that? Wants to change your name. I mean, isn't that what he said to Jacob? He says, hey, I'm changing your name from Jacob, heel catcher, to Israel, governed by God. Something rad. And of course, after this, Jacob still does some boneheaded stuff. It's not like he goes from his name being changed to Jacob to Israel. Now he's just perfect in every way. Not at all. Okay? We're all a work in progress until we don't have a pulse anymore and we're in heaven and then we're perfected. But until then, we're going to do this at times. Hopefully we go from doing this to more like that, right? That's the hope and desire for God and for us, I'm sure. But something significant took place where his identity was changing. I mean, think about this. If you had to take a pick, let's just take whatever you're going through right now that you go, man, there's some significant pain in my life and some betrayal and some issues that I would love to not have on my plate, not some baggage I'd like not to have in my life. If you could have God take that away right now, he's just going to take it away, whatever it is, whatever physical infirmity, whatever spiritual trial, whatever guilt, whatever pain from betrayal, whatever Esau's in your life, if you could just say, God, I just want you to take it away and I never have to deal with that again, but you never change or grow from where you're at right now, or you carry this thorn in the flesh, this hip out of socket for the rest of your life, but God changes you from being a conniver to someone who's really governed by God. Honestly, which would you pick? Do you think that we're willing to go those places without pain to inspire us? We're not, because we don't change without pain. We just don't. We would rather not. But see, that's really the heart of this story, what we're seeing going on here. This is a major change. 20 years ago, it's like here, Jacob is lying. What's your name? Who is this in the tent? Oh, I'm Isaac. Right? He's lying about who he is. 20 years later, after a world of pain and problems, what's your name? Oh, my name's Jacob. If we're really going to find significant healing and a deeper identity with God, we have to be honest about where we're at and who we are and what we're dealing with, right? It really has to happen. That is actually the catalyst that brings that moment about where you go, everything changes. I desire us to be a people here at Reveal Fellowship that really deal with stuff. Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, some of you, as I've been a Christian since I was 18 years old, all right? And going to church all my life, and one of the things that always have become nauseating, beginning in my own life and in the church itself, is where we come in and we pretend that we're at one place, but we're really just saying, hi, my name is Isaac. That's what we do. And what's really going on in closed rooms, there in our bedroom, there what we're listening to on the radio, the conversations we're having with people, all the stuff that's really going in our household, for example, we would never bring that into church because it doesn't line up with the presentation that I'm Isaac, right? And that's what we do. And many times we do it because we go, that's just the way it is. And I'm sure for 20 years, Jacob was like that. You know what? I'm not happy that I've been alienated from my dad, who I have some bitter roots and some rejection wounds, and I always felt like I was never good enough. I was never Esau. My mom was just a poor example. I loved her, but she used me and manipulated me to get what she wanted, so she's acting like she loves me, but then she used me and manipulated me. I don't know how to feel about that. And my brother Jacob, he wants to kill me. For 20 years, he's just going, I just don't want to deal with that stuff. Right? I would imagine there's like a garbage dump of stuff in this room where we could go, man, I've got some stories, and they're just not dealt with. And every time we start to feel a little sadness or pain, we do something to go, oh, Lord, I just pray that you would bless that person and deal with it. And we throw some little token prayer up as a means of somehow responding to the Holy Spirit to say, turn and go back to the land of your fathers. Go back and deal with that area. It's not a matter of establishing salvation. It's about establishing a deeper walk with him. Who doesn't want a deeper walk with Jesus, right? I mean, I want to take the camouflage off my arms. I want to be honest about who my name is. I want to be honest about what's going on. And I don't want to put my hope in anything or anybody else of something they have to do or not have to do in order for me to feel like I am who God says I am. I think there's a major identity crisis in the Church of Jesus Christ, major. It's just, it's an epidemic in the church. And the craziest thing is, Jesus says, I call you by name, right? What is that? Like, you call me by name. I mean, Revelation, he says, I'm going to put a new name on your forehead. I'm going to give you a stone with a new name on it. What's this whole name stuff? It's basically, I'm giving you my identity. You were born in sin. You were born in the womb wrestling for control. You were in the womb born trying to self-promote, right? We see a lot of that in the church, self-promotion. We want to take the gifts God's given us and somehow we want to promote ourselves. Why? Why do we do that? It's about trying to find out who we are. That's what we're doing. And does it work? It doesn't. I mean, it's almost like a drug. It feels good for a little bit, and then you feel empty a week later. Come on, right? It's very quiet in here right now. You know, because I know this is not, Dave, I'm just visiting here, dude, and I was just looking for a fluffy sermon to make me feel good, and you just ain't bringing it, bro. I get it. I understand that. But this is just, you know, I'm sure that Jacob wasn't like, oh my gosh, my brother wants to kill me, 400 people, and now I'm separated from everyone that I love and find an identity in, and now this angel is bringing me this wrenching pain. This is the day from hell. No, it's a day from God. And he's ordained and designed all this so you can cross over and find blessing from the Lord. Wow. How does that hit you when you hear that? Do you hear that and go, you know what, Lord? I'm Jacob. I'm Jacob. I love you. Lord, I've been to Bethel. I've seen the gospel of grace. And I've tithed my heart and everything about it to you. I've given you over. And I've walked with you. I've devoted to you. But I've been in denial for many years. And I've tried to medicate and mask and camouflage. I come in with a mask at church and I pretend to be something I'm not. And I'm done with that today in Jesus' name. I am done with going, my name is this, or this people expect me to be like, I'm done with that, Lord. I want you to name me. I want you to bless me. Because if you name me and you bless me, it won't matter what anyone else thinks. And I'll be able to look at the favoritism I dealt with my dad, the manipulation I dealt with my mother, the betrayal with my brother and my betrayal towards him, the abuse, all the things that I went through that you didn't like, but you allowed to lead me to a place. I'm going to look at all of that as you're sovereign, you're my God, and you are working through it, and I praise you. I give you the glory for that, God. So you who allowed sovereignly pain to come in my life, I'm asking you to bless me. And that doesn't necessarily mean that you're taking the pain away. It doesn't work like that. It's kind of like when someone loses something and someone and you're at a funeral. You know what? A year later, is the pain gone? No. The pain is still there, right? Do you ever want the pain to go away? Why would you want the pain to go away? Why would you want 5 years to go, I don't want to miss that person. I don't want to, like, man, I just wish they were here and I feel a sadness that they're not. You would want that to go away. I wouldn't want that to go away. My grandmother, my dad's side, there's not a week that goes by, I go, man, I just wish she was here right now. I just miss her, you know. What does it produce in me at that moment? A tender heart, compassion, a gratitude for life, an ability to go, things that someone does that's bothering me, should they really bother me? Because in the scope of the big scheme of things, really doesn't matter. No. My nanny, we used to call her, would do some things that were just so goofy. And it used to annoy my grandfather sometimes. If you could just imagine Archie Bunker and Edith, you know, it's just sometimes he would just like. But I tell you, after someone dies, those things that you might have found a little annoying, you really don't think about those anymore, do you? You really don't. Why? Oh, the pain, the reality of loss and all that you feel, that gives you a different perspective on the things in this world, does it not? A production of pain, a fruit of pain, a heavenly perspective that's birthed through pain, through loss. All these things are gifts. If we're willing to embrace them and go, God, I'm willing to just do whatever you want to do. I'm willing to go wherever you want me to go. If you want to remove my ability to be out of denial, see, that's what God's doing with some of us tonight. He's like touching you in a certain area and you're feeling the pain. You're going, I'm sitting here in this chair, Dave, and everything you're saying is kind of keeping me in this tunnel vision of thinking about this area of my life of pain and betrayal and fear and inferiority and insecurity. And I don't want to think about this stuff. So can you please finish this sermon so I can go to Chili's and have some chocolate, because I'll feel much better if I can do that, right? And that's what we want to do. But you know what we could do instead? Oh, we could worship. We could pray. We could grab a hold of Jesus and say, Jesus, I need you to bless me. I'm going to stop looking for other people to bless me. I'm going to stop looking for other things to bless me and make me feel better about me. Instead, I'm going to hold on to you, and I am not letting go until you bless me and release me from the fear of Esau, the pain of rejection, the pain of favoritism, the pain of manipulation, all that stuff, God, that's just tormented me and kept me somewhat divided in my love and devotion, my prayer life to you. I worship you one day. I worship things the other day. I want to get rid of that. And the only way it happens is going, go ahead, in the midst of this pain that's been stirred up in me tonight, I'm grabbing hold of you, Jesus. Are you down with that? Because I want you to know that's where we're going tonight. I'm going to ask some of the leaders to come forward and be over to my right and left worship team. Go ahead and come on up. And we're going to spend some time with Jesus tonight. Because as you've been sitting there in the chair tonight, some of you are wrestling. You're wrestling with the Lord. So you've got a choice. You ready? Here's the crossroad. Don't let me just keep your attention for a couple more minutes here, because here's the crossroad. When you hear a message like this, you'll have a tendency to go, I don't think that's for me. And some of the things that you're talking about, not only right now, Dave, but some of the things you've said to me in the past, I don't like it and I don't think it's right. It hurt too much, really, is what you're saying. And you weren't. But here, God gets to a place where he says, for 20 years, I've been wanting you to deal with this, and now I'm going to have to deal with it in a way you will not like it, and you're going to have a hard time reconciling as God because it hurts so much. But let me tell you what, God is patient, but there's a place where he says, let's do business, because I've got greater things for you down the road. You hear what I'm saying? Let's pray. Let's go before the Father tonight. We believe, God, that when we're weak, you're strong. We believe, God, that you love us enough to inflict discomfort in our lives. Your great love refuses to leave us in a comfort zone that we can live in for so many years. So we just want to welcome you, Father God, tonight to come and speak to us as a father would speak to his children. Some of us, even now as we sit, Lord, we're just wrestling in prayer with you as to whether we really want to acknowledge reality. So we welcome you tonight, God, to come and open up our hearts to trust you again. To thank you, Lord, for however you want to touch us, however you want to speak to us. God, I want to pray right now for those in this room that feel orphaned and abandoned. God, it's affected so many relationships in their life, and a fear of intimacy, God, that's just kept them at an arm's distance from everyone around them. God, I believe that tonight you want to call that down. I believe you want to remove that, even though there'll be a pain and a limp. You want to relieve them from the ability to run from that any longer. Father, I want to pray tonight for the person who has suffered, God, with sexual abuse for years and hurting, God, and just identity issues, shame, all the things, God, all the lies from the enemy. Father, I'm asking for breakthrough tonight. I'm asking, God, you would pour out healing and a renewal of mind, Father God. We know, God, that you do miracles where there's just an inability to hope, God, for purity, for safety. God, I pray that you would establish a bold faith to trust you for what doesn't make sense in the midst of pain. God, that you would give that person the ability to grab a hold of you tonight and not let go until you bless in the name of Jesus. Father, we welcome your Holy Spirit to come and remove the barriers of pride that we hold up. God, you alone are wise. You alone are strong. You alone, Father God, are worthy of our trust. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, to bring about a humility in this room right now. Saints of God, I would just welcome you right now just to stand to your feet. Continuing attitude of prayer, just stand to your feet right now. Father, we take a stand tonight believing, God, that you are in this place and that you are touching certain areas, God. You are removing the veil of denial, Father God. We are welcoming you, God, your voice in this place to speak to every soul that are standing at their feet right now. If the Lord is moving on your heart right now, I'm going to welcome you a minute as the worship team begins to lead us in worship. There's going to be prayer counselors to your right and left. If there's something going on, you do not hesitate to say, I'm going to get prayer tonight. When you go there, you're not going to tell your story. What you're doing is you're going to come into agreement where there's two or three witnesses, right? You're going to go and say, I'm coming into agreement tonight that the blessing of the Lord is coming upon my life in this area of pain, this area of fear, this area of resistance to God. I am calling out blessing tonight. I want God to govern me tonight in this area of my life. I'm finding freedom, and I'm not letting go tonight until I find that militant attitude. That's what I want you to come with that prayer counselor with. Because God is going to touch all those who tonight would listen, family. Come. Come. Father, we speak just a blessing over all those that would leave their seat and press in and say, God, I'm laying a hold of the garment of Jesus tonight. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, to move in this place.